Sorry, guys, you're live. You can go. We can hear you.
Hi. Hi, thanks for joining our conference session. We'll talk about how to build an Android TV media application launcher and other topics closely related to that. So let's see what will be the agenda for today. First point, we'll talk about the Android TV growth, in particular in the last years, that involved also TV boxes. So we'll get a big focus on set of box framework, so in the TV boxes and how to customize it in its firmware and how to interact with the framework. And then we'll focus also on the ecosystem of the set of boxes, and we'll get a specific focus on some areas. Then we'll talk about media contents, that is the main purpose of the set of box world. Then a specific focus on how to customize the Google Assistant for TV operators. And then a review summary and possible innovation on that. So let's start with Android TV growth. Google at the last year has announced that Android TV and Google TV have more than 80 million active devices. So this is a big milestone that puts Android TV, respect to the other rivals that are Roku and Amazon Fire TV, with more than 50 million devices. So this means that Google say also estimated that in the May 2020 there were 50 million active devices, and in the last month this number has increased to 80 million. So this means that there is a 60% growth year of the year. So Android TV is involving both smart TV and TV boxes as well. And according to a comprehensive research report made by Market Research Future, say also that Android TV is growing rapidly. There are some reasons. First of all, is the Google Play Store, that is an open system respect to the other TV brands. The Google Assistant, that is a feature embedded in all devices. And for sure, the great impact of the OTT platforms, such as Netflix, Disney+, Amazon Prime, et cetera. The development of live contents, linear channels, and digital video broadcasting, cloud gaming also for, there are some services like GeForce Now from Nvidia Shield, Google Stadia. This the major impact is North America, so dominates the market, and also the COVID-19 pandemic has a catalytic effect on this industry. So just a focus to what is a set-top box, which we will focus on today. So the box looks like a metal plastic block box. It's like a DVR. It's a non-portable throwing device and can add some smart features to a TV monitor, like TV application or the, also the digital television broadcasting. So it has some connectors on the backside, like the HDMI ports, digital optical cable, and an antenna for the digital video broadcasting. So let's see how it can be customized set of box. So if a vendor wants to customize set of box, we need to use not a basic application like the one that we put on the Play Store, or, for example, for mobile smartphone, but to use a specific system application that has the, a particular access to the to some protected and restricted permission. So we are putting that into the Android OS system image, into the system pre-app folder, and they are signed with the platform keys to, in order to access to this protected restricted permission. So what can be the most important app to be customized for in Android TV or set of box is the TV launcher for sure. That is that represent the homepage of the set of box, and is in this app that is a most constantly running, meaning that needs also to be perfect bug free and graceful in terms of CPU RAM usage. These are the permission the categories that we have to add in the manifest file to be a launcher. And also another important app is the TV app, that works with the Android TV input framework and allows to access to the TV inputs that could be channels, linear IP channels or digital video broadcasting channel, for example. In our experience, we combine these two apps with a unique app that we will call TV App Launcher. So we know that works with the TV input framework, TV inputs, and with some OEM manufacturer's library. Other apps that could be customized in our setup box could be the custom settings. So if a provider wants to customize the Google panel settings, we can do that, just adding these two permissions. And also the possibility to bind to a custom wizard from the Google setup wizard to add some other custom configuration. For example, if a vendor wants to give the access to the login page, to the accounts for the provider. Another important thing that we saw in our experience was to use a good approach to handle different set-top box manufacturers. So a multi-vendor manager in our case was useful to adapting a Unix system TV Lab launcher to many different manufacturers. And for sure, the manufacturers should provide to you special boxes that that are open set of boxes with that with a firmware with user debug and root root permission. So in this with this set of box, we are able to install and testing our system. And other peculiarity that we should manage, we have the library from OEM manufacturers. So the OEM manufacturers can provide to us some custom libraries in order to access to some custom APIs. An example could be an extension of the TV input framework that we talked before, and we focused on that with Alessio. Read or modify system properties. So the possibility to access to some properties specific for the vendor. So the product board, for example, to avoid to install this, the application to other platforms, the way clock, display settings, et cetera, et cetera. The possibility to access to private databases, so private content provider for low-level info, for example, for the TV provider, for the antenna part, and the customer serial number, and so on. And for sure, we have to take care about the different Android API level compatibility. Another important thing to be considered for a setup box is that it should be also a carrier to be a media aggregator. So the most important thing is that on the homepage of a TV app launcher, we should provide and recommend streaming contents from all the OTT platforms. So it's now crucial for the setup box launcher to recommend all these contents. There could be two different approaches. One is the more standard flexible, that is the backend approach, but it requests a partner integration. So each partner, you should apply a specific backend integration. Another approach is the client-to-client approach, that is the one suggested by Google, how it works. These APIs are the recommended channels. So Google suggests to use these channels, and each partner, for example, Netflix, Disney, and so on, can write on the TV provider, on Android TV, is on recommended movies and series, and also programs already started, in which, for example, an Android and the setup box launcher can retrieve these contents and take it from this TV provider and suggesting to the home screen. For example, the Watch Next Channel Row can be shown in order to show the contents already started from the beginning. I will pass the word to Alessio to continue the slide.
Okay, let's talk about set-top box ecosystem. We can introduce the set-top box ecosystem speaking of eight major topics of interest. In the next slide, we will talk in depth of some of these. Now we list some of these topics. The first, Google OTA, because firmware updates, installation on user debug set-top box can be done using a USB, but for production set-top box, the update usually takes place via Google OTA. Another topic is Activity Launcher Lifecycle, because depending on firmware implementation, Android Broadcast Intent regarding launcher activity may be different compared to the standard one, for example, in our reboot feature, and we will see in depth in the next slide. For Android low memory killer, because the RAM is a critical resource in Android set-top box, because it is required minimum 3 GB of RAM. A large number of applications is installed and are executed in the set-top box, and this can cause low free RAM. Activating on the firmware side the persistency allow the launcher application to stay alive. For the wake clock, this is a mechanism to indicate that your application needs to have the device stay on. And for our purposes, it is important that the set-top box doesn't have a network standby. In our case, during the application standby, to keep the user section active and to avoid when wakes up the set-top box a login, we can make some user-based calls and every 10 minutes to keep this session alive. For the wake clock, is simple to enable, because is simply an Android manifest permissions, user permission wake clock, and we can use the acquire method to enable the wake clock. The stability and test automation, because test automation is mandatory to have to achieve a stable and reliable product. And core use cases to be covered are boot and the standby wake up for the boxes, channel zapping if the user is in the live section, play video on demand, long run and stress test. The remote controls, because we don't have a standard remote control like the television remote control, because we have that the manufacturers can customize this remote control with some specific key. The remote controls can be used wirelessly or all infrared, and using the Bluetooth, there is the possibility to interact with the voice with the set-top box. The anti-flooding policy, because the set-top box may become a source of DDoS attacks. Launcher architecture can be avoided to call the backend in the same moment or an infinite loop. At the end, the connectivity issues, typical connectivity issues can be Wi-Fi out of range, connectivity availability after a boot or a standby of the set-top box, and the real check of the internet connection. But let's see more in detail some of these of the aspects listed before. Lifecycle management. It is important why during our development. We have seen that in set-top boxes for different vendors, we noticed that the Android custom intents are not standard. The Android intents are not standard. So we studied in depth this management, and we have to manage this state to avoid the malfunction of the application. The most important states are boot and reboot, because the boot is a physical boot, and it means that we can remove and plug in the power. For this state, we have the creation, the starting and the resuming of the application, and the launcher tries to authenticate the user. In this state, we have boot completed and screen off intent, because the firmware simulates a pressure of standby button when the box is turned on. For the reboot, we can talk about soft reboot, because it's performed via the restart option of the menu. and is like a deep standby. So when we press again the power button, the set-top box turns on. The standby, because if we press the power button of the remote control, the box reach the standby state. In this state, we have the stop of the activity and the screen off intent. But we don't have a network standby because, like we see, like we talk about before, if we implement the wake clock, it is possible to have the network on. For the deep standby is the same of the standby, but is obtained pressing the power button for a time measured than 3 seconds, and at the start of the top box we have a boot. When we are or the user are have the box in standby, pressing the power button of the remote control, is this possible to wake up the set-top box? In this state, we create we have a screen on intent, a check, a connection check, and at the end the user authentication check. The OTA update. This is important. This is an important state because the OTA updates of the application take place during the last impact band for the users, the night usually, with the box in the screen off status. So it is important because we have seen before of one of the aspects of the of the ecosystem of the set-top box that is anti-flooding prevention. In this state, we can avoid that all the customer base, the entire customer base of the of the set-top box makes the login at the same time. So here we randomize the login on after a boot, and at the end the auto reboot, because we can perform periodic auto reboots to avoid overload caching and leaking of the process OS. The remote controls. We have seen before that the remote controls are not standard, but we can have that the manufacturers or the vendors can customize the buttons of the remote control. For example, the on button, because the user when the user is in another section of the application or the set-top box, for example, on an external app, or in a detail page, in play a live live content, or play a video on demand. If the user press the on button as a shortcut to return to the home of the launcher. The interaction with the Google Assistant is possible to the Google Assistant button. And if the user press this, if the application, the launcher application, has the interaction with the Google, it is possible to search a content, play directly a content, or tune a DTT channels, a digital terrestrial channel. The live TV button, because we can bring the user automatically on the live video. But on some remote controls, this button, we have two buttons, one for TV guide section and one for TV channels. In this remote control, we can see only one button. And on application side, we can customize this, the behavior of the application pressing this button. The info button to see some details of the content that is in focus. And the settings button, that is the a shortcut to go automatically on the settings menu of the set-top box. For the connectivity issues, we use Google APIs to interact with the network. In particular, we use a network callback of Connectivity Manager, and we interact with some four major methods, that is on lost, on available, on unavailable, and on capability changed. When the network capability change, so the box has a transition from a disconnected state to a connected state to a disconnected state, we can bring the user on an offline page. This is a problem because sometimes there can be false positives or deriving from the decrease of the intensity of the signal, low band problems. So to be sure that the network is really absent, we rely on a further custom check. So the application could contact a backend service to give the correct indication of the presence of the network. At the end, to finish our discussion on set-top box ecosystem, we can talk about the monitoring tools. We can have three important topics. This is crash management to resolve bugs quickly using a real-time crash management, gain contextual insight into crashes, and never miss a critical crash because we can enable real-time alerts for the new crashes. The analytics tracking to track the updates. So if the user change, for example, a view or move in the application, if he makes some actions, so we can track the actions of the user in the application, and we can track the crash to know the stability and the health of the launcher. And at the end, we can customize. We can make a custom maybe application to understand if the application lifecycle, the network issues, or the user preferences, for example, to undertake an appropriate market strategy. We can use this for technical tracking of video quality too, because the video, the purpose of an Android TV media launcher is to play contents. That is, that can be video on demand or live content, live streaming content. For the video on demand, we can see that video on demand is a media distribution system that allows user to access video without traditional playback device and the constraints of the typical static broadcasting schedule. We can use for this content is implemented the digital right management for restricting the use of proprietary copyrighted works. For the purpose of Android TV, we can use two DRM scheme. That is one of these is PlayReady. This is a media file copy prevention technology from Microsoft. It is platform independent and it supports MPEG-DASH and HLS. And Widevine. Widevine is a proprietary digital rights management from Google, used on Google Chrome and Firefox, used on Android TV devices, and it supports MPEG-DASH and HLS. To focus how we implement this the video on demand management and the DRM, we can see that we use ExoPlayer, that is an application level media player for Android from Google. It allows plays audio and video locally and over the internet, and supports some important features like DASH and HLS fruition, and ExoPlayer is easy to customize and extend. This is important because we can interact with the DRM session manager method of ExoPlayer to send the custom data to the ExoPlayer. And if the DRM scheme is PlayReady, we can see that the optional key request parameters map from ExoPlayer can be enriched with the custom data that usually are cookie of the user custom data from contents. And or for a Widevine, we can cancel optional key request parameters and enrich the DRM callback with Widevine custom data and Widevine cookies. We have talked about video on demand. The Android TV, an Android TV launcher plays live contents too. What allows us to interact with the live video is the TV input framework. A TV input framework simplifies the delivery of the content for the Android TV and provides a standard APIs for manufacturers. The components of the of a TV input, the major components of the TV input framework are TV provider, that is a database of channel programs and associated permissions, TV app, that this is the app that handles the user interaction, and the TV input manager that allows the TV inputs to communicate with the TV app. The flow of the application is that the user interacts with the TV app. The TV app displays the audio video contents from the TV input, and the TV input manager identifies the state of the TV inputs for the TV app. For the channels that we can play on an Android TV media launcher are linear IP channels or DVB-T channels. The linear IP channels are television content delivered over internet protocol networks, offers the ability to stream the source media continuously, and can have some interactivities like time shifting, this is the recording of a programming to a storage to be viewed after the live broadcasting. The catch up TV, that is the replay of the TV show that was broadcasting hour or day ago, and the start over TV to replay the current TV show from the beginning. Let's focus on the player that we use on the Android TV media launcher, that is ExoPlayer, like the video on demand. ExoPlayer is important because ExoPlayer is important because we can play most adaptive live streams out of the box without any special configuration. And ExoPlayer is the correct player to use because adjust the live offset by sliding changing the playback speed. We can detect and monitor the playbacks from ExoPlayer because the player has some listener, and we can interact with some events, that is on timeline changing events. There is some methods exposed by ExoPlayer, like get duration to know the length of the current live window, or for example the get current position to know the playback position respect to the live window. We can configure the parameters of live playback from ExoPlayer, or for the single media item interacting like here, or globally for all the media items interacting with the default media source factory. And we can interact with ExoPlayer to raise intercept some errors using this on player error method. And we can with this we can decide to show to a user a simple pop-up to raise the error, or we can keep the live video to the default position. For the DVB-T channels, we can use a DVB-T scanner, another application for the launcher, to scan and save this type of channel, these digital terrestrial channels. This application, the DVB-T scanner, interfaces with the set-top box APIs diversified by vendor. We can use, we have a listener or a broadcast receiver, and we can intercept some events like started, progress, completed, or aborted to scan and save these channels. At the end, when the channels are saved, we can interact with our backend to enrich this the schedulation of the channels and the programs. We can have the possibility to put some channels in the blacklist, knowing the user rights. We can interact with the proprietary API of the vendors, understanding if the antenna is connected or not, and we can check if some specific frequency is okay to know if it's possible to tune a particular channel. For the future, we have that in Italy, in after 2023, we can has been ordered the DVB-T2, that is the abbreviation of Digital Video Broadcasting Second Generation Terrestrial. Is the latest generation standard for the DVB, for the digital terrestrial, and is important because this standard will allow an improvement of video quality and high definition. Talking about the video quality, for video on demand and linear IP channels, we use adaptive streaming, because the adaptive bitrate streaming is a technique used in, for streaming multimedia over the computer networks. It works detecting the user bandwidth and the CPU capacity of the user to adjust the quality of the media stream accordingly. The result in using of adaptive bitrate streaming is little buffering, faster time, and good experience for high-end and low-end connections. In particular, we use the dynamic adaptive streaming, that is MPEG-DASH, is an adaptive streaming bitrate that enables the quality streaming media of video content over the internet, over HTTP protocol. And it works by breaking the content in some segments and serve all the bitrates to the users. From Lollipop API level 21, Android device manufacturer can be implemented another important feature for the set-top boxes, that is tunneled video playback. This tunneled video playback is intended primarily for the Android TV. And promises benefits such as audio-video synchronization, better audio-video synchronization, smoother video playback, better support for 4K, better support for HDR, and lower CPU load. For ExoPlayer, we can see in the slide that for Home ExoPlayer 2.2, there is the support of the tunneled video playback. We can use the method set tunneling audio session ID of the track selector to enable this. I give the floor to Marco for the last slide, Google Assistant and the summary.
So let's talk with a particular integration that we done for the TV launcher, the Google Assistant. So the launcher app or any system app for your set of box could be declared as operator main app or operator assistant facing app. And this should mean that this app will be the app that will interact with the Google Assistant app. This permits to your system apps that will be declared as operator to customize the results of the Google Assistant in your set of box. So if a specific provider wants to customize the first row of results of the Google Assistant or implement any kind of particular interaction with that, you can do that because Google provides to TV operators a specific documentation, a specific APIs. So in our case, the operator main app and operator assistant facing app was the same app and was the TV launcher. And so the interaction between the Google Assistant app from client point of view with the operator app is done with an ideal interface that is provided from Google. So let's see how it works, the architecture of Google Assistant for a TV operator. So, as we told you, the assistant facing app register is ideal service with Katniss. The Katniss is the Google Assistant app. So, when a user has done a request to the Katniss to interact with a Google Assistant, the Katniss app get this ideal service. And you can get an access token that is generated from the assistant facing app in a custom context. And this ensures that the communication is The communication between CATNIS and the assistant facing app is with is with a big big is with a security level that is important, no? And also the CATNIS app gets also the device model D. The device model is a specific JSON config file that an operator should put into the cloud platform of Google. And into this, the device model is present. There are present some metadata that are important to customize, so the UI for the Google Assistant part. So when the CATNIS forward the assistant request to the cloud, to us an assistant server, the assistant server communicates with another parts that the TV operator has to customize, that is the operator cloud service, that is the backend part that interacts with the assistant server, and it gets the response. And so when the assistant response goes to the CATNIS send the Android intent to the operator main app. This is all the architecture how it works. So just to summarize again, an operator client apps that are system apps, in our case was the TV app launcher, interactive Google Assistant app from client part. In the cloud part, there is a device model that is configured by the TV operator and the operator cloud service that interact with the Google Assistant server. Here we can see an example how we customize, for example, the results for the Google Assistant part. when the user interacts with the Google Assistant, the providers can prioritize his results on the first row of the Google Assistant. Then if you can scroll down, you can see the choice from all the applications. Here you can see some example that we implemented in our TV launcher. The first example was the search, so the media content search, so explore media content by keywords, for example, from genre or from actors. So, for example, searching actual movies, searching movies by Tom Cruise, etc., etc. Searching the entity search, so search a specific media entity, so a specific movie. Play a specific movie directly, so the interaction should be play specific movies, and the TV operator gets into this part. Play a specific channels, so tune to a specific channel, and view the PG data for a given channel and time span. So open directly the TV APG from your TV app launcher and see what's going on tonight on specific channel. This was possible due to feed ingestion of all the contents into the cloud platform, and also with the client integration that we saw before. So to conclude, an overview summary for what we've seen and possible innovations. So we see some data, 80 million monthly active devices on Android TVs, and we have also the 80% growth only on the USA, and 60% year of the year, how we see in the first slide. 7 of the top 10 smart TV as choice Android TV, and also 160 TV operators as choice Android TV, and 7,000 apps are present on the Google Play Store for Android TV. The main topics we discussed, we saw that how Android TV operators needs to customize firmware for end users. The set-top box firmware customization are based mainly to TV app launcher. So the TV launcher is the main core of all the customization that we can do on the set-top box part. We saw also with Alessio that the lifecycle development is tricky and the risking strategies are necessary. So we should implement specific the risking strategies in order to handle all the lifecycle development that is very particular for a launcher. Multiple partner integration for media creators are increasing in demand, so it's much important to show contents into the homepage for a TV launcher in order to guarantee a complete experience for all the OTT platforms. Possible innovation from under TV and set of boxes are that are also constantly evolving. The first thing that we saw is that and then for Android TVs are missing the push notifications, So only system notifications are handled from Android TV sites, and this is a big limitation for Android TV, and we hope that in future Google handle it and have the possibility to access to it. And also to another possibility from our from hardware side could be that TV boxes should be also seen as a smart device, so embed a smart speaker into the TV box. We saw also that there is a first box with this feature, and also probably the possibility to be an hub or a bridge in order to connect devices in a smart home platform. So thank you for joining our session.